analysis of faceless assessment, learning so far and way forward. I think in this digital arena, this is the most relevant topic that we are going to discuss today. And in fact, we have very renowned panelists in the session today. So with this, I would welcome Mr. Pranav Sehta. First of all, he's the chairman of the FICCI Taxation Committee. And in fact, he does not need any introduction. Very senior international tax and transaction services leader, EY India, with more than 30 years of experience in the practice of direct tax law. And in fact, sir has been consistently rated as one of the leading tax advisors in India. So we are very grateful, sir, that you agreed to join us for the session today, for taking out your time. And it has always been a pleasure to hear you. And we are looking forward to your insights. And we also have Mr. Romit Patel. Mr. Patel is also a tax partner with EY India. He's a qualified chartered accountant with over 15 years of experience in the field of taxation. At EY, he is a partner specializing in corporate tax, international tax, and transaction services for companies in the technology, media and entertainment, and telecom space. Mr. Patel has also represented clients at various appellate and regulatory forums in India in resolving disputes with authorities, including mutual agreement procedure. And he is also part of EY India Tax Desk Rotation Program and was based out of Chicago for 3 years. Welcome, sir, to this session today. We are looking forward to hear you.
Thank
And
you.
another panelist in the session today is Mr. Rahul Patni. He's a digital tax leader, EY India. He's a partner with EY Tax Practice in India and has 20 years of work experience. In the past few years, he has been working with companies to help shape their digital tax agenda, bring automation and process improvement in the tax function, and implement optimal operating models. And he's advised various companies on international tax structuring and litigation matters. Welcome, sir, to the webinar today. Looking forward to hearing you. And another panelist in the session today is Mr. Rakesh Gupta. He's Vice President and Group Head, Tax RPGA Group. Mr. Gupta is a chartered accountant cum company secretary with over 25 years of industry experience. He got vast experience of working for various sectors like manufacturing, financial service, retail, information technology, and real estate. And his expertise goes in direct tax, international tax, as well as indirect taxes. He's currently working with the RPGA Group as Vice President and Group Head Taxation, and he's responsible for RPGA Group and Indian Conglomerate, having interest in infrastructure, plantation, etc. He was also earlier for more than 2 decades with Aditya Birla Group. So welcome, sir, to the webinar today. And I would, on behalf of FICCI, would like to thank all the renowned panelists today, all the for taking out your time and agreeing for this session today. So with this, I would hand over to Pranav, sir, and Mr. Patel would be, I think, sharing the presentation after that. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much, Ira, for those kind words of introduction, and good afternoon. A warm welcome to all of you on this particular webinar on faceless assessments, extremely topical indeed. And we hope to have a good, nice discussion this afternoon. What I would also request at the outset itself is, if you do have any questions, please feel free to the Q&A box, which is different from the chat box, and we would endeavor to answer those questions either as we go along, if they are connected with the discussion already happening on this panelist webinar, or towards the end. So please do feel free to post in your questions so that we have insights even from all of you and are able to address some of the points from the expert vantage point of all the panelists. Of course, what we are confronted with today is a sea change in the way assessments are being made. The government's agenda seems very, very clear. It is leveraging on technology like never before. It is putting together various legislations and filings made under different laws, and ensuring that all of them align and reconcile together. It is using information obtained from various domains, including exchange of data between authorities, even internationally. It is even endeavoring now to provide pre-filled tax returns. The date probably is not too far by which we will see the government knowing more about our incomes than we do if we are not very well organized, as is the case in my own case. So what we are seeing now is the use of technology by the government is to the hilt, and to a large extent that is driving change. Also, there is indeed a big desire to expand tax base and to ensure that more and more taxpayers are transparently within the space of tax. What we are seeing is a significant use of technology in various different spheres, whether it is in terms of case selection, whether it is in terms of geography where my relevant officer is sitting who will do the assessments, whether it is in terms of the kind of interface that the taxpayer has with the revenue authorities, whether it is in terms of the leveraging of the various talents and functional expertise that the revenue has to ensure uniformity and consistency of how things are being handled, and so on and so forth. So there is a complete change in the way in which the assessment system will operate. The earlier regime, the way it was, and the faceless regime, the way it is likely to be. We have seen already the first cycle, and what was probably expected to change, a lot of it seems to be already materializing in front of our eyes and unfolding as we are talking. Romit, maybe we can go to the next slide. So if we look at the experiences of the first cycle, of faceless assessments, it is not that it is very much different from what probably was expected to a very large extent. And if we look at it, this trend is likely to only continue and grow. A lot of it, like crunch timelines, which was always expected, is sometimes showing its face in very, very ugly terms as well. And we have various writs and so on, with crunch timelines being almost an understatement, if not more, and so on. So here are we in a situation where probably the way in which we used to handle tax audits, tax assessments, has completely undergone change. And if we look at how this first cycle has unfolded, most of the experiences that we were expecting have really materialized or not. Let me start first with a question for one of our panelists, Rakesh Ji. The question, Rakesh Ji, is while it is still admittedly very early days, and we don't really know how it will still further evolve as we go along, what is your early experience in this first cycle of faceless assessments? Do you think the revenue authorities have got their focus completely right, appropriate, as was likely to be the case? Are they really focusing on key significant issues, matters of vital importance, or are they still nitpicking? There are tidbits being picked up, trivial issues being sought for and addressed. Are they looking to go after big ticket legal items, arguments, matters, or are they still being very, very factual in their approach? So what are you seeing as the early trends here is the focus right, and what do you think is likely to follow? Over to you, Rakesh.
Yeah, thank you, Pranav, and thank you, Frinky, to for this opportunity to speak to August audience here. So, Pranav, as you said rightly, before when this scheme was announced, it was one of the biggest change which we heard, that after GST, it is the most revolutionary thing in the taxation field. Actually, nobody would have thought of that we'll have some kind of this scheme where your assessment will be done sitting across the across your screen actually, and there will not be any physical one-to-one meeting actually. And we were used to visit the officer, sitting, waiting there, and explain our case and argue with him actually. So when this scheme was announced, means like all large corporate was really worried that how that our case will be presented, how the AO will be able to understand our business nuances actually. But I must tell you that the first round of this faceless assessment, which has happened, the experience was surprising, very pleasant actually. Okay, so whatever the worries or whatever the issues which we had in our mind actually, we didn't face. Largely assessments were very smooth, barring few of the exceptional cases actually. Means like questionnaires which we received from the officers was very, very up to the point actually. There was no general queries that like we used to have in physical assessment, the cyclotyped queries that give the details of debtors, creditors, expenses, balance sheet item, P&L items actually, and we used to submit a lot of box files to the officers. I think all those was not there at all. Whatever the questions which came was very, very specific. I think more or less they were concentrating on reasons for which your assessment has been, your case has been selected for scrutiny. So a lot of questions was on and around that, what we call it as region action. Okay, and I think means like another emphasis which we have feel that lot of emphasis was toward that reconciliation issue actually. So there were a lot of questions around you reconcile your numbers with the turnover as per the your GST return or service tax return at that point of time actually, and what is your reported in your tax returns actually. Wherever there were large transaction, definitely there were questions around that actually. But I think those are also very, very specific actually. There were no roving inquiries from the department. So overall means like experience was very smooth. Though there are a lot of other issues which were bound to happen about the timelines, about the video conferencing, whether you get the chance to present your case properly with the assessing officer. I think we'll discuss that during the course of our discussion. But I would say this, we were really, really pleasantly, and not only me, means like wherever we speak to our industry colleagues actually, hardly anywhere I've heard that there was high-paced assessment. Everyone was more or less very happy with this process of this faceless assessment.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Rakeshji. That was very and indeed that if it helps achieve the award objectives of the government in introducing this e-assessment program in terms of enhancing efficiency, transparency and accountability, I think it will be absolutely great, and probably India can move a little closer to ease of doing business in terms of actual on-ground reality, even from the taxation side. And let's move to Romit. Romit, you have also been at the forefront of handling some of these faceless assessments and helping clients navigate this journey from the erstwhile system of physical to the new system of faceless assessments. Indeed, the faceless assessments are probably the exceptions. One of the exceptions is the International Tax Division. but you handle a lot of corporate tax and other assessments as well. So let me ask you, what has been your experience as regards the nature of questions that are coming about? How would you compare and contrast the two of what was your experience prior to the e-assessment scheme being introduced and now? And do you see a perceptible change in the approach, in the mindset, how they are bringing forth issues, asking questions, or do you think that it has been largely similar? Would you echo Rakesh ji's sentiments in terms of your experience by and large?
Sure, Pranav. But Pranav, you know, before I get into answering your question, you know, I want to just share one key learning with the audience, which has been that given this entire faceless regime, I think the emphasis on being ready from a data standpoint and from an information standpoint to be able to face these faceless assessments has been I think the topmost learning for me as a professional and when I deal with a lot of our clients who are assessees. But coming back to your question, I do agree with Rakesh ji that the notices that we have received during the course of these faceless assessments, the 143 tools, etc., they come across as being well thought through. So they are not roving inquiries. Yes, in some odd cases, we've seen that the information that is being sought for, you can't really gauge what are they after, or they are asking for bank statements and ledger accounts and all of that. But by and large, what I have seen is that it is a tailored, customized notice which is being sent to majority of the assessees, asking for information which is relevant to their business. And there is quite a lot of evidentiary value in terms of being able to gauge that they've thought through this and they are going through the past records and the past history of assessees before they send out notices. Other point is that yes, there is a lot of emphasis on the reconciliation items such as revenue appearing as per your TDS form 26AS and what is appearing in your books. The GST authorities and the income tax department at long last have I think started communicating and they are asking details such as reconcile the revenue which is appearing as per your GST filings and what is reported in the financial statements. So there is a lot of emphasis and focus on those kind of items. But when I look at it at a broader level in terms of how is the trend emerging, whether new issues are coming up, how are they dealing with the past issues, are they just blindly repeating the past historic assessments or litigation items, there are a couple of key or couple of pleasant experiences that I had which I would like to share with the audience. And one was a case where there was a charitable institute as many may be aware that you have to file a form 10 for accumulating income for the next 5 years. We had AY 1617 assessment which had happened in this case, and the tax office had said that your language in the form 10 is very vague, and this was during the course of physical interaction, and they made a huge disallowance. Now this year when we went into the assessment, obviously they had the past year's assessment records, we submitted the form 10, and they have pleasantly not gone ahead and made that adjustment, which in my 15 year career is a first, and it gives me hope that they have applied their mind and they have looked at all the records and reconciled that the adjustment which was made in the earlier year was presumably not one which would ultimately sustain against the taxpayer. There are cases which I have also seen where on factual issues, when submissions have been made, the point has been put forward, data has been submitted, the tax authorities have been bold enough or brave enough to go ahead and take a call that an adjustment, even though it might have been made in the previous year, does not merit a disallowance or an adjustment to the taxable income. So all in all, I think this has been a pleasant experience. I completely echo what Rakesh ji mentioned. Needless to say, there will be learnings on both sides, one from the department's perspective, given that the system is still evolving, the platform is evolving, and also from the taxpayer side, because they will also have learnings in terms of how to gear up for future rounds of assessments.
Thank you so much, Romit. That was again very have you encountered such a pleasant have too many pleasant experiences while dealing with the tax administration in India, I might say, sorry to say that, but have you had this refreshing experience where after due consideration, raising the query, listening or rather reading the SSC's responses, going through the SSC's responses, even matters on which in earlier years adjustments have been made were dropped with full understanding and after due consideration in the wake of these faceless assessments? Have you encountered any situation, any of your entities in which even a single such adjustment was dropped after due consideration? And how do you think this could impact the revenues orders in the prior years, especially assuming facts are exactly the same? So are they giving up on those even for earlier years? What would be your initial reaction to that?
So Pranav, means like as far as that experience from the industry perspective, what I can say, as far as the old issues are concerned, actually, where that you have a ritual kind of additions, actually, every year addition, they keep on making everywhere that matter keep on going at the appellate stage and get stuck, actually. Okay, and then department goes and the matter keep on from one level to another level, actually, without any end. I don't have seen any kind of improvement in that, actually. In most of the cases, they just repeated what has been done for the has done in the earlier year, actually. Like right. You have a unique problem of doing the 14A disallowance. They simply pick up your asset and liabilities investment and they do their the mechanical calculations. Okay, even after making so much of assessment, so much of means like submissions, I have not seen any change in that. So those things continues to happen, actually. Far as new issues are concerned, I completely agree with Romit, actually. In fact, there was certain very specific questions on certain transaction, like where you've done a large acquisition, you claimed appreciation on goodwill, actually, okay, or you claimed appreciation on brand, actually, or there are certain incentives which you have claimed, or some chapter 6A deduction, actually, okay, where there was specific questions, specific point was asked, specific explanation was asked, actually, and once that explanation was properly given, there was not too many to and fro, actually. If your submission was very crisp and up to the point, actually, which is well explained itself, explainable, actually. And ultimately, excellent. And even means like in one or two cases, we have realized that in the draft assessment order, there was large additions which was proposed, actually, on some large business transaction. And after that, proper submission was made to them. The means like all factual data was placed before the authorities, actually. And ultimately, in final assessment, those additions was not there, actually. So
that is
I think that shows that, you know, means like there is a complete shift in the mindset of the people doing the assessment. And I presume that lot has been the kind of mechanism which they have created about this technical unit and verification unit. That also, that is my presumption, that they also played a very active role. It's not like that one person is taking decision. I think these matter must have been referred to them, and they must have also taken a very, very reasonable or very correct legal position, and ultimately those issue was not raked up in assessment.
Very, very interesting.
I think this is a very, very good experience, I would say that.
Very, very interesting. So I wanted to ask, the draft assessment order contained an adjustment. It went probably at the back end to the review unit. Accepted after due consideration. That's a very very, very pragmatic thing, and objectivity is coming in into the process.
So in the things are correct after draft assessment means like in some of the cases we asked for the personal hearing, actually. So instead of doing the personal hearing, in fact, the final order means like those issues by itself was not to be seen actually.
Very, very healthy indeed. So coming back, you know, one of the things that one has observed, and not that it was completely unexpected, one of the things that was expected as well was that there'll be crunched timelines for various submissions. So it was to some extent expected that there will be a demand of intense levels of efficiency and so on. But what has been on the ground, because we've seen various kinds of writs and so on in this regard, this is coming on Friday evening to submit by Monday morning. Is this something that is just a passing phase, initial teething troubles? Have you experienced it or not so much? What's your experience in this area?
No, I think this is the major concern actually. Okay. I think that is the only complaint which we can have in this entire process. Means like it most of the time it happens like that, though the scheme provides for the 15 days timeline to submit our responses actually. Okay. But most of the time you get the notice on Thursday evening or Friday afternoon, and they are expecting, they are giving the timeline that you have to submit your reply by 1 o'clock on Monday actually. So and then language of the letter, that means like the response is not submitted within this timeline, it will presume that you don't have anything to say on that, and assessment will be completed based on the documents or information available on the record. Okay, so I think that is something that was the biggest hitch actually. Okay, and even whenever this draft assessment order was issued actually, I think they were expecting that reply should come to the draft assessment order within 24 hours, 48 hours or sometime. And even if you are asking for the adjournment, saying giving that some genuine reason, you will not get too much of time actually. They will give max to max another 24 hours or 48 hours. So that was the biggest challenge because there was otherwise also restriction, there was a limitation because of availability of the manpower, availability of the team, means like availability of the documents actually. Most of the people were working remote places actually. So I think this is the only that is the only means like which I can see in the entire process. And I completely agree what Romit has initially mentioned, that it is also required that lot of proactiveness from the SSC side. This we can't expect that means like we'll get kind of time and kind of comfort what we used to have during the physical verification, physical assessment. So in the physical assessment time means like even if you are half ready, you would have gone to the you and you will explain him that this is I am submitting this much and balance I will give in another 2 days or 3 days. You don't have that kind of luxury here. Your reply has to be either no reply or you have to give the full reply actually. You can't expect that one question you will give reply in three installments. So I think that was the biggest learning about the productiveness, use of technology, means like our own internal documentation, and how good we are prepared. That will only means like help us in getting this process smoother. Otherwise, sure. This problem is going to remain.
Quite true. And coming to Romit, Romit, every change indeed in life is painful, especially when there is a major change. No doubt about it. The thing is, on balance, is it justified? Is it bringing in more good than bad? Otherwise, improve lives. What has been your overall assessment of this faceless assessment? Your assessment of the faceless assessment cycle one. Are there more positives, and what are these? Or have there been too many challenges? And if so, what are these? And to what extent do you feel that the administration has the mandated procedures, protocols, and adhering to the requirements, and how has your experience generally been, and what do you think clients have been saying also, with whom you regularly interact on this as well?
So Pranav, let me start with the positives. You know, and I couldn't agree more with you know what you as well as Rakesh ji mentioned. There is you know, there is apparent applicability of mind on the part of the tax authorities, and especially so because of the way they are constituted. So you have your verification unit, you have your assessment unit, verification unit, technical unit, review unit, and I think they all, that entire machinery seems to be working in a well-oiled fashion. And case in point was, you know, we received a huge show cause saying in the draft assessment order that under 69, we're going to make some, you know, obnoxious adjustment because of unexplained investments. And that could have had, you know, huge ramifications for the assessee. And what we did is that we made a submission saying, you know, providing all the factual information. And because we didn't, you know, because it was a material issue for the assessee, we also requested for a video conferencing facility. But by the time they accepted the video conferencing facility and sent us the link, we also saw an internal file note saying that your submissions have been considered and that adjustment has been dropped, which was very impressive, because obviously there is you know, consciousness that we don't want to go ahead and make frivolous adjustments which are ultimately not going to sustain. So that I think was one of the biggest you know, positives that I saw coming out of this. And like you said, there are challenges with you know, a system or an initiative of this magnitude. So you know, these video conferencing facilities, a lot has been spoken about that. You know, we've had experiences where the tax authorities have rescheduled or have not turned up for the video conferencing facility. In the situations where we have, or in the instances where we've had that opportunity to do a video conferencing, we are talking against a blank screen and it's like a monologue, and there is no, and you just can't make out whether there is an appreciation of facts and what we are submitting or trying to submit from the other side. And at the end of it, you know, there will just be a dialogue which will come. I don't know whether that is also pre-recorded or not on a lighter note, but it just says that, okay, your submissions have been duly noted. And 24 hours later, you'll have an assessment order which all the adjustments which were proposed.
So even the screen was faceless.
The screen was also faceless. You're absolutely right. And the other biggest grouse is really this lack of opportunity of being heard. So, you know, as we were talking about it, that you get a notice on Friday saying submit on Monday. During pandemic times, people working from home remotely, access to data being a challenge, that's tough. And that's why we've seen a plethora of writs being filed, you know, with the courts, and the courts have been, you know, very empathetic of that. And they've restored the matter back to the assessing officer saying that you do need to provide an, you know, opportunity of being heard. And the, you know, demands have been stayed, the assessment proceedings have been stayed. So I think all those things will evolve over a period of time. But I think one thing that our audience should also note is that, and I have seen that work, is the conciseness and the lucid manner in which you make a submission is very, very important. Because, you know, they're asking you for 30, 40 things. It's almost, you know, factual. But if you submitted in a manner in which you are able to drive home your point in the most efficient manner, in a very concise, crisp and lucid manner, I think that that works, because they are able to quickly pick up the point to say that, okay, this is what the assessee is trying to say, rather than going round and round and round in circles. I think that works.
Excellent. That's very, very interesting. So being able to articulate your position in a very succinct manner and clear is what makes all the difference, especially in now this faceless assessment regime.
I think Pranav, I think that timing was also one of the why this we can because they started very late actually. So when the due date was 31st March actually, before the time got extended actually. In most of the cases, the assessment process started somewhere in January or early February actually, and that is why I can presume that they also didn't have too much of time actually to wait for the submission from the assessor, because they were also to complete their assessment within time limit. So
Right.
That may be one of the reason actually. Yeah.
So I mean, from one of the participants, there is an experience that he is sharing that in the draft assessment order, there was no disallowance. But in the final assessment order, he finds a disallowance for the first time. That seems to be very, very unfortunate and unique. I don't know whether Romit, Rakeshji, you have anything to say.
No, Pranav, that happened in various cases, Pranav, because I even heard the cases where they didn't even send that draft assessment order. Okay, and all of a sudden, one fine morning, you find your assessment order on your email. So they ask for certain question, you replied, and you are waiting for their revert actually. And without and surprising to get the final assessment order in your end with huge addition. So I think some writ petitions has gone, Pranav. I personally know that some writ petition has gone to Bombay High Court also, and writ petition has gone to Gujarat High Court also, where the assessment has been direct. Instead of giving the draft assessment order, they have given that direct final assessment order.
Yeah, but it just becomes too much of a harassment for a taxpayer is easily equipped to go for
yeah,
it.
It happened. It happened.
So the sooner this gets resolved, some of these seem to be hopefully only teething troubles, and they will not subsist. Maybe department also is facing the challenges due to the pandemic. Maybe it's too new, so they are also coming to grips with this and so on. So hopefully.
So I think only one suggestion, wherever these things has happened, actually department is very beautiful, and I think it is effective also. That is, there is one platform, e-Nivaran actually, I think. So wherever there is a high pitch assessment, or they have formed one committee, so wherever the complaints are going on that platform actually. And so one can try on that, and what I understand, that results are also good actually. Wherever that there is a high pitch assessment or unreasonable adjustment has been made in the assessment order, and people have approached to that route to the committee, I think solution has emerged.
Very good. That's so not every case need necessarily to be carried into writ, which is good. So yeah. Rakeshji, coming back. You know, every change calls for a preparedness, some degree of proactiveness to ensure that one is ready to cope with it. What has been your experience? And that is on both sides. The revenue administration has to be prepared for it, and the taxpayers have to be prepared for it. If we look at it from the side of point of view of the taxpayers, what has been your experience when you see around, including in your own group? Are the right systems in place, the right SOPs? Do you think that there is a general readiness to be with all that face assessment? How about, you know, readiness of putting together some of these data points, especially the various reconciliations, now that they are reconciling and asking for alignment of various filings under different laws and different regulators as well at times. So what has been your experience in terms of preparedness of the taxpayer community in general?
Yeah, so Pranav, I think challenges were many actually. So the biggest challenge is that predictability of what kind of questions will come in. Okay, in case of physical assessment, when you had continuous interaction with the tax officer, actually you can read his mind, and you can assess what questions are coming, and you can keep yourself ready actually. But here is a completely darkness, means like what kind of questions will come, what you should prepare actually. So what you can do is that you will prepare based on your last 2-3 years assessment, what are the information which has been generally sought actually. You keep all those factual information ready, you will keep all those evidences ready actually. If you all any big transaction has happened, or any position which has been taken, you will keep all those submissions and your argument on those items ready actually. But I think the biggest challenge was that whatever the questions came actually, okay, means like you must have thought that question will come on a point,
but it has come. It is just like exam you have prepared for chapter one, but the question has come from the chapter two. So I think that was the biggest challenge. It's like, but nonetheless, preparedness, readiness at our own level is very, very important. Actually, we have to, and SSC knows, he only knows what position which has taken. Actually, assessing officer can only pick up only few out of that actually, but he knows his own stand and what position is taken and how strong is he is there on each position which has been taken. So I think it is very, very important that everything is kept ready actually, and we have already seen one cycle of assessment actually. It gives a good learning for the next cycle. And other challenge was mainly because this pandemic actually, availability or accessibility of the document, PPL and everything. So if you want to give submit something, actually the documents are lying somewhere. Getting those documents, getting it scanned and giving to the AO sometimes become challenging. But I think those are not very big issues. More or less, things could be managed very well.
Yes, admittedly, hopefully that should be ironed out soon. So Rahul, yeah. If I might ask, you know, we have seen the Indian government in this case at the forefront of change. It is leading the change. Whether we compare them with other governments, regimes, administrations, even in some of the more developed and mature economies, and refreshingly, they are ahead, I think, in many cases, even compared to the taxpayers. And here I'm talking of large listed entities or, you know, very marquee companies as well. So it's becoming a real refreshing change that we are seeing, that the government is leading this change. How do you think the taxpayers can work in certain areas themselves, and how do they use and leverage technology as well, like the government is leveraging on it so heavily? How does the taxpayer also, in what areas you think they can really leverage technology to make the best of this and make it even more simpler for them to cope with this big change?
Sure. Thanks, Pranav. I think I fully agree that government is quite ahead, and the amount of resources that government is spending, clearly this is one of the pillars for them to augment the tax base, given the low tax GDP ratios that we have in India. I think from an industry point of view, clearly there is an opportunity to do more in this area using technology. I mean, I do work back with many large companies, and I clearly see one trend is that, look, GST in many ways one can say was a forced adoption of technology. People did not have a choice but to go the government way. But on the direct tax side, still somewhat I feel that even in large companies the adoption is a bit slower. Those who are ahead of the curve, I can share some examples of what is being done. As I think all the panelists said here, that these are not photocopied submission questionnaires which are being issued. These are very targeted, custom made questions being issued. And how it is happening, I think the answer is very simple, that there is a huge machinery which is available to the assessing officer at the back end in form of data analytics. They are working in the background who are analyzing the balance sheets, P&L accounts, ITR, tax audit report, because we must remember that every single filing which is being made to tax and other authorities in India is a truly digital filing. It is completely machine readable. And therefore, you are seeing the quality of notices being very, very sharp, very targeted, and which is going to become even more sharper going forward. So the question is, why is it that companies can't do some of that proactive analytics while filing the income tax return or immediately after filing the return? And there are ways of doing that. There are solutions available. Essentially, what needs to be done is that there are certain parameters that department will look for while scrutinizing your return or tax audit report or financial statements. Some of the companies which I'm aware of, they have proactively run this analytics on the returns filed, and they almost have like a proactive checklist or a preemptive checklist of what questions are going to come when the assessment starts. So therefore, you are, by doing this, you're achieving two objectives. A, you know, addressing the problem which I just heard is the, you know, lack of time. So if you know to the extent of anywhere between 60 to 80% what will be asked, so you're prepared well in advance. And second is, you can work back and gear up your IT systems, ERP, such that that information now starts coming directly from the ERP. You don't have to put, you know, people spending days and weeks and months just to sort of prepare for that. So that's one point in terms of proactive preparation, sort of using analytics. Second is in terms of digital readiness. So, you know, again, when I speak to clients, there were some clients who were extremely happy with this whole faceless assessment and work from home, because what they did was, a year back, year and a half back, 2 years back, they implemented some of the digital systems for controversy management, litigation management, assessment management, which means that they had pretty much all the information available with them through their laptops. They did not have to visit office even once. Equally, I came across companies were struggling because they said, what do we do? Everything is lying in box files and we have to go to our offices, you know, which itself had its own challenges. Now, going forward, when we hear more and more companies are promoting work from home, and even otherwise, we've experienced the advantages. So the second, I think, clear thing which is worth considering is moving into a digital format in terms of storing, keeping all the repository and everything. And third, I would say, is try to be a little ahead of the government in its thinking. And I'll just give one example. We are aware of this Section 194Q, which is proposed to be coming into effect from 1st July. Now, it's a very simple amendment. They're saying there will be a TDS of just 0.1% on sale of goods. But you come to think of it, it's very clear that government is not wanting to collect tax by this 0.1% TDS. It's not going to make any difference. The only reason they are doing is because they want data. And they want this data then to be reconciled with many other sources and then come back to you with even more targeted questions. I mean, let me just take one very simple example. And let's take a company which is into consumer products. It would have, if not more easily, 1,000 distributors all over India. Now, each and every distributor, provided it is above a certain threshold, will now be deducting TDS and reporting the purchases made from this company in the TDS return. So therefore, now the Form 26AS of this company, the seller, will be in hundreds of pages. Now, you start to imagine, as a company now, how will you deal with it? There are just way too many entries in 26AS. And imagine when your faceless assessment starts 12 months from now, there will be a very simple question from an assessing officer. He will say, you have sold goods worth 10 crores to this customer, but this customer is saying that he has purchased goods worth 12 crores from you. Why is this 2 crore difference? And if you can't explain, it's a simple addition to your income. Now, it's not that you've done anything wrong. There are plausible, you know, reasons, because there is a timing difference, because there are sales returns and so on and so forth. But the question is that, have you realized the real intention of these amendments, and are you working towards it? Because this amount of data, when it will come and hit you, it'll be very difficult to do it in those 2 weeks time frame and whatever which the department will give. So this is the third and last point which I wanted to make, Pranav, was that just think ahead of some of these changes, why they are being made, and try and stay ahead of them while you are now getting ready for the next wave of or the next years of faceless assessment.
Thank you, Rahul. That was very, very helpful indeed, and I'm sure that will help tax in advance. So coming to Rakesh ji, I mean, very quickly, one last question for you. We are likely to see completion of the first cycle by 30th June of this year, and very soon one or two other cycles also will be close of this one. So by March 22, we'll probably see even more experience in this area. What according to you lies ahead, and what do you think organizations, taxpayers should bear in mind to be better prepared for these very soon approaching upcoming assessment cycles?
Yeah, Pranav. So Pranav, before coming to specific answer, actually, let me also, at least I am very cautious on the fact, actually, this year, because of this pandemic and kind of direction from the government, actually, to be lenient, actually, and not to harass the assessees, that also may be one of the reason why this assessment processes has been very, very smooth, actually. And I am very clear that this can't guarantee that the same thing will happen in years to come, actually. As the system get evolved, they are also become more handy of the information, okay. And the entire purpose of having this faceless scheme is that you have a industry specific specialist who will be doing the assessment, actually. So it's not like that one assessing officer is doing of one particular area, actually. So you will have that. Ultimately, in the years to come, you will have that one unit is specific for technology companies, one unit for the EPC companies, one unit is for the real estate, or one unit for the manufacturing, actually. And real challenges will come at that point of time when the common issues which is faced in one assessment is rolled out in the other assessments also. Okay, so I think it's very early days to party that these things will continue to remain smooth, actually. There are reasons behind that why this was smooth, actually. So at least as a group, means like we are fully conscious of this fact, and I think we are taking lot of steps, actually. What Rahul spoke about, that digitizing that entire processes, using more and more technology, robotic processes to fetch the data from the system. Means like tax team has to be more knowledgeable about that use of the technology, use of the accounting softwares, actually. Whatever the position which we are taking is that should be very, very consistent, actually. You can't keep on changing your position from one year to another year, actually. Okay, and proper documentation of those policies. And I think we are very, very cautious now on how do we plan, actually. So a lot of planning and a lot of aggressive planning which we used to do, actually. Okay, the way the tax laws are evolving and way the shaping out, actually, we are very, 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 very conscious that what position which you are taking and whether that position is completely on board, actually. So we should not take any position which is very, very risky, and those will continue to take the position, but we are very, very, very conscious of that fact, actually, that what position which we are taking and whether it is saleable or not saleable. I think a lot of learning, Pranav, and means a lot of things needs to be done, actually. Tax role is completely changing, actually. It's not what we used to have historically.
Understand. So one of the participants has posted a question. He's had a very bad experience of the e-assessment regime in the first cycle. A lot of irrelevant questions have been asked, inconsistency in adjudication of issues amongst different companies, so no uniformity, for example, in relation to 14A disallowances, some completely non-comprehensible additions being made of a deduction which was never claimed, got disallowed and added to taxable income, and so on. So Romit, very quickly, what are the remedies that are available in such a case of a huge demand getting created out of nowhere? Rakesh did mention about e-Nirvana. What do you feel, or what would be your thoughts on something like this if it were to happen to a particular client?
I mean, first and foremost, Pranav, if you know, in this particular situation, if there isn't been an opportunity which has been afforded to the client of, you know, presenting their case on, you know, some particular additions which have been made, I think alternative remedies to try and get a stay from the High Court, you know, may be explored. Obviously, you have your traditional, you know, appellate mechanism, which is available to say that you go to the CITA, ITAT, and all those kind of things, try and get a stay by paying the 20% demand. All of that will obviously is the normal course. But if it is a really, really high-pitched assessment and where the principles of natural justice have presumably been violated, then alternative remedies to seek relief may, you know, may be considered appropriate.
And this again, maybe Romit, you can chip in. What are the internal changes that have been made at the revenue end? You know, in terms of trying to cope with this, are the same people doing the job? Is the question, which seems to be the case. Are they trained adequately enough? Are they really, you know, taught to think differently, and how has the department been trying to cope with this change? Any insight?
No, I think Pranav, that work is being done by the same set of people actually. But I must tell you that kind of the new breed of officer which are coming in the system actually. So every year you have a lot of new officers which are joining actually. I think their approach is completely different what we used to have for traditional way actually. Okay, so I think they are very, very pragmatic. Their knowledge level is also very high actually. And I think a lot of work has been done by the government to impart education, to impart training to these officers. And the other thing which I get a feeling is that there is a lot of positive kind of messaging from the top actually. So I think that is leading the entire change in the mindset of the people, how they used. So earlier that every time is like when SSC is sitting, always they used to look at the suspicious actually. So this, but now that is not the case actually. I think. Even before the faceless also, some kind of feeling started coming that now approach is little better actually. We the way the transfer pricing assessment used to happen, the way the DRP used to happen actually, the way the normal assessment used to happen. I think some shift was already visible, and which is only strengthened in this faceless assessment actually.
Sure, we are already. Above the hour, but one very quick comment I will put before both of you. There has been a decrease or drop in revenue collections in respect of corporate tax compared to individual taxes. The question is it because of too many clean assessment orders passed and the faceless assessments scheme? And probably the fact that even disallowances additions made in earlier years have not been made in this year, pleasantly surprised. But I must share that one of our clients who was speaking to me in confidence, they have faced such a huge pleasant surprise where after full due consideration, the revenue did not make this disallowance in the current assessment, despite it being made repeatedly in the past. And a lot of submissions were made, it was filed, and the question is there some kind of failure of the technical unit or review unit, or is this really a refreshing willingness to look at more pragmatically, more objectively, without being influenced by what happened in the past? Very quick, one or two lines, Romit, from you and then from Rakesh ji before we wind up.
I mean, I think this will evolve, Pranav. I think sector specialty plus a lot of training as well as the quality of officers will improve, and we will see there being a balance or a semblance to proceedings going forward. So this pleasant experience may not last a lifelong, and it won't continue to be a party, because there is obviously that much pressure on collections and so on and so forth. And the other point is that we would have all seen that there is a huge uptick in the 148 reassessments also, which are happening for 6 years, 7 years, 8 years. So I think that is also something which the department is doing parallelly.
Excellent. So, Rakesh ji, any final
thoughts? So Pranav, only point which I want to touch upon is that though we have already seen assessment actually, but I think we should not forget the way this section 147 has been redrafted, and the way that white power has been given under 263 actually. And in the case of physical assessment, you had a you had a lot of opportunity to check what kind of audit objections are coming actually, and we'll have to wait and watch for what happens in next 6 months or 1 year, when this whatever assessment has happened, that files are picked up for audit by the audit team, and what kind of issues they highlight actually. And now it is a information based reassessment rather than your reasons to believe based reassessment actually. So I think we'll have to still wait and watch for that, how it pan out.
Excellent.
One must see that revenue authorities, whether it is physical or whether it is faceless. So
excellent.
They can always be brutal.
Excellent. Yeah. I would be failing if my duty would thank each one of you. Romit, Rakesh ji, Rahul, for your very, very insightful. For me, I think there are a lot of takeaways. One of them indeed is that while this change is here to stay, and we better prepare ourselves to cope with it in the best possible manner for sure, there is indeed a pleasantness to this first cycle experience. Whether this is here to stay for good, that we are not too sure. The faceless assessment scheme is definitely here to stay, but whether this pleasantness of the experience, which has been by and large the feel during the first cycle, will continue in the long term, will be here for good, we have to wait and watch. Hopefully it will be a lasting change, and will ensure that India matures in terms of how it deals with its taxpayers, and how tax administration can be far more pragmatic and practical, and it could probably help the economy considerably in various different ways. So let's keep fingers crossed, but at the same time, really prepare ourselves, tighten our seat belts, proactively think of how we can be ahead of the curve in coping with this huge change. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen, for joining this afternoon. We really appreciate it. Do send in any further questions that you have, and we'll be happy to consider them. Over to you, Ira, if you want to say some last words, and before we wind up, please.
It's been a very, very interesting session today. I think we got I'm sure all the participants must have got a lot of guidance on how they need to go about it, how do they need to prepare for the next cycle of the assessments. So definitely this has been a very interesting session, a lot of useful insights, and thank you to all the participants. We'll be sharing the presentation shortly, and thank you once again, Pranav sir. Thank you to all Mr. Romit Patel, Mr. Rahul Patni, and Mr. Rakesh Gupta. Indeed, it's a pleasure that you have joined us today in this webinar. Thank you to all. Bye bye, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Take care. Have a great day, all.
Thank you.